What Maisie Knew by Henry James. Read by Maureen O'Brien. The litigation had seemed interminable, and had in fact been complicated. But by the decision on the appeal, the judgment of the divorce court was confirmed as to the assignment of the child. The father, who though bespattered from head to foot, had made good his case, was, in pursuance of this triumph, appointed to keep her. It was not so much that the mother's character had been more absolutely damaged, as that the brilliancy of a lady's complexion, and this lady's in court was immensely remarked, might be more regarded as showing the spots. Attached, however, to the second pronouncement was a condition that detracted for Beale Farange from its sweetness, an order that he should refund to his late wife the £2,600 put down by her, as it was called, some 3 years before, in the interest of the child's maintenance, and precisely on a proved understanding that he would take no proceedings, a sum of which he had had the administration, and of which he could render not the least account. The obligation thus attributed to her adversary was no small balm to Ida's resentment. It drew a part of the sting from her defeat, and compelled Mr. Farange perceptibly to lower his crest. He was unable to produce the money, or to raise it in any way, so that after a squabble scarcely less public and scarcely more decent than the original shock of battle, his only issue from his predicament was a compromise, proposed by his legal advisers, and finally accepted by hers. His debt was by this arrangement remitted to him, and the little girl disposed of in a manner worthy of the judgment seat of Solomon. She was divided in two, and the portions tossed impartially to the disputants. They would take her in rotation for 6 months at a time. She would spend half the year with each. This was odd justice, in the eyes of those who still blinked in the fierce light projected from the tribunal, a light in which neither parent figured in the least as a happy example to youth and innocence. What was to have been expected on the evidence was the nomination in loco parentis of some proper third person, some respectable or at least some presentable friend. Apparently, however, the circle of the Farangers had been scanned in vain for any such ornament, so that the only solution finally meeting all the difficulties was, save that of sending Maisie to a home, the partition of the tutelary office in the manner I have mentioned. There were more reasons for her parents to agree to it than there had ever been for them to agree to anything, and they now prepared, with her help, to enjoy the distinction that waits upon vulgarity sufficiently attested. Their rupture had resounded, and after being perfectly insignificant together, they would be decidedly striking apart. Had they not produced an impression that warranted people in looking for appeals in the newspapers for the rescue of the little one? Reverberation amid a vociferous public of the idea that some movement should be started, or some benevolent person should come forward. A good lady came indeed a step or two. She was distantly related to Mrs. Farange, to whom she proposed that, having children and nurseries wound up and going, she should be allowed to take home the bone of contention, and by working it into her system relieve at least one of the parents. This would make every time for Maisie, after her inevitable 6 months with Beale, much more of a change. "More of a change?" Ida cried. "Won't it be enough of a change for her to come from that low brute to the person in the world who detests him most?"
"No, because you detest him so much that you'll always talk to her about him. You'll keep him before her by perpetually abusing him."
Mrs. Farange stared.
"Pray, then, am I to do nothing to counteract his villainous abuse of me?"
The good lady for a moment made no reply. Her silence was a grim judgment of the whole point of view.
"Poor little monkey!" she at last exclaimed,
and the words were an epitaph for the tomb of Maisie's childhood.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.